Okay, let's start the meeting now. Morning, I'd like to welcome all of you here today where we meet to improve lives locally and globally. I am the president of the most awesome and fun Rotary Club of North St. Paul, Maplewood, and Oakdale. Isaac Menza, would you recite the Pledge of Allegiance?
I would love to. Waiting for the flag. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Isaac. Let's see. I'm going to just pull somebody. Rick Pratt, would you say the five-way test?
Two. The five-way test of the things we think, say, and do. Number one, is it the truth? Number two, is it fair to all concerned? Number three, will it build goodwill and better friendships? Number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? And number five, is it fun?
Hey, thank you, Rick. Joel Miller, would you lead us in an invocation or words of encouragement?
Encouragement for you. And it comes from multiple people. So hang in there with me. First off, if I cannot do great things, I can do small things in a great way, by Martin Luther King Jr. In the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. And that is by Eric Hansen. You must do the thing you think you cannot do, by Eleanor Roosevelt. Now, this a lot of these relate to our times and what we've gone through, are still going through. So kind of think of it in that terms. Be the change that you wish to see in the world, by Gandhi. It doesn't matter how slow you go, as long as you don't stop, by Confucius. A champion is defined not by their wins, but by how they can recover when they fall, Serena Williams. Our greatest weakness lies in giving up. The most certain way to succeed is always to try one more time, Thomas Edison. Soon all will be well. You're going to look back on this period of your life and be so glad you never gave up, Brittany Grunder. You just can't beat a person who never gives up, Babe Ruth. The most effective way to do it is to do it, Amelia Earhart. Make up your mind that no matter what comes your way, no matter how difficult, no matter how unfair, you will do more than simply survive. You will thrive in spite of it, by Joel Osteen. And lastly, people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. By Maya Angelou. And hopefully those are some thoughts that you can think through your day and find a place for them. And I think we all have a place because of the fact this last year has been tough. We've all been locked in. We've been locked away from our friends. I think there's been times when we would like to have turned away and given up, but we didn't. And that's what's important to learn from these tidbits. That's all I have.
Thank you, Joe. That was very nice. Okay, I don't see Randy Greeley, so we won't have a Friday morning wake-up quiz. And I'm going to change around the order of the meeting a little bit so that our guests can get back to classes. So I'm going to turn it over to Brian Chemnitz here first, and he can do some of the introductions.
Good morning. This is always a nice time of the year for introducing and understanding and getting to know an excellent student from the Hill Murray School. And it looks like Kelly is going to be making that presentation or introducing the student. So Kelly, if you'd be so willing to take over the Zoom meeting and introduce the student.
Thank you. So we have Arnie Johnson here today, our Rotary winner from Hill Murray, and Aaron Herman, our high school principal, is here along with Arnie's parents, Nisha and Johnson, and his sister. So we wanted to give them a special welcome. So there's just so many wonderful things to say about Arnie. He's got a great sense of humor, respectful, driven to succeed, which he will talk to you about, a certain love of family and Hill Murray. He's a wonderful mentor to our younger students. He cares deeply about his classmates and the community at large. Arnie is a gem because his emotional IQ is certainly as high as his intellectual IQ. Arnie was recently hired for a once-in-a-lifetime esports broadcasting internship for the Minnesota Varsity League. So he will be working with one of the world's most successful esports casters. Arnie's involvement in our esports has taken him to the state tournament this past winter, and he will again represent Hill Murray this spring. He is definitely a fan favorite, as I have watched him on Twitch as he's competing. And Arnie so far is waiting to hear back from Stanford and Notre Dame, and that speaks highly to him being a well-rounded, amazing young man. And without further ado, I am so happy and proud to introduce Arnie Johnson, our Hill Murray Rotary Student of the Year.
Good morning. My name is Arnie Johnson. Thank you for giving me Student of the Year. It means a lot. I think, especially at Hill Murray, there are a lot of kids that easily could have won it. But I think, you know, there's always something that can be said or something that like sets each individual apart from others. The thing that would definitely set me apart would be my pursuit of knowledge. It recently, especially I think towards the beginning of high school, when it came to homework or like school in general, there wasn't a drive, even though I do well. But whereas now it's beyond school, I've been able to grow in, you know, many of the experiences that I've had at Hill, the people that I've met, especially the students and teachers, each one has impacted me in their own way. And I think that's just to say what kind of environment that this place has been for me. And especially I've always had the sense of gratitude throughout my life. It's always, my parents have always put me first. And when you start seeing that, when you start seeing the selfless love over and over again, it's infectious, and you start to it starts to appeal to you more and more. And even coming to Hill Murray was almost out of reach simply because of the tuition price. But thankfully, I was able to get a scholarship, which allowed me to work in the summer to pay off my tuition. And without opportunities like those, I feel like I wouldn't be in the place that I am today. So.
Well said. Tell us a little bit about your family.
Yeah. So I have a mom, her name's Nisha. I have a dad, his name's Johnson, and my younger sister, Tashvi. She's in eighth grade, and next year she's gonna also come to Hill. So right when I graduate, she'll be entering as a freshman. So it's cool.
What type of education are you going to be pursuing once you leave Hill?
I don't know. I wake up every morning thinking maybe I'll do something new. I've always been interested in a philosophy, but then I've just been, I guess, wary of pursuing that simply because I don't know its applicability. And so I'd have to like double major, I feel. But also I'm always passionate about technology, and I'm pretty good at like computer science. So I might major in that, but I also have a decent business sense. So I'm really not sure yet. I'm still thinking about it.
Well, if you go into the IT world, make it easier for us older people so that we don't have to work so hard trying to figure out all these apps and everything. That'd be appreciated. You mentioned you had a summer work with a scholarship program through Hill. Maybe you can kind of describe what you did over the summer.
Yeah. So the summer before my freshman and sophomore year, as an underclassman, it was like the dirty work, I guess you could say. We would scrape the gum off the lunch tables, the bottom of the lunch tables. We'd clean out lockers, vacuum the library and carpets. We'd wipe the walls of the gym and just stuff like that. And the work may have seemed menial and taxing at first, but you know, looking back on it in hindsight, I realized that I really appreciate that. It's very easy to take for granted how much work goes into money. And just knowing how much effort and work you've put into that allows you to cherish it more. And so because I knew how much work I put in over the summer, I was able to appreciate just being at Hill much more than the average student. And the summer before my junior and senior year, we changed things a little bit. So since I was an upperclassman now, they let us tutor. So it was me and four other kids. And we were tutoring kids from kindergarten to eighth grade in reading, math, and if they were younger, like first or second grade, we'd definitely take more breaks with them, do some coloring. So it was definitely more interesting and a lot different. Yeah. It was a nice change of pace though.
Well, I hope you stayed within the lines when you were coloring.
Yeah.
Do we have any other questions from any Rotarian?
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to hear a little bit more about his sports broadcasting.
So, the Minnesota Varsity League has a couple games in it. It has Overwatch, Smash Ultimate, Chess is one of them, and Call of Duty. And Rocket League. And so this started the spring of my junior year is when the Varsity League was first established. And then the last tournament, which was this fall, I was competing in it, and I ended up placing third at the tournament, and it was a lot of fun. But now I saw that there was a chance to broadcast, and I always knew that I had game knowledge. And so it would be me and another caster. He's the more experienced one naturally. And so I would be the one, he'd be like the host caster, kind of managing all that stuff. And I'd be more of a color caster or analyst and be providing like details and just like helping the audience understand what's happening and why players are doing what they're doing. And that does mean I can't play in the season this year, but I mean, it's the opportunity itself is much more valuable, and the knowledge that comes from it is worth more than just one season of playing. So I'll just be, it's like a sports like commentator basically. I'll just be casting the games, talking about what happens, why players are doing this, you know, matchups, and just different like parts and aspects of the game basically.
But what games and what are your favorite games to broadcast?
I only broadcast Smash. It's the full title is Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. It's a it's kind of like the Avengers of video games, I guess. So different video game characters will be like put in an arena and they'll like fight against each other. I'm sure most people here might know Mario or Pikachu. So just characters like that from different games, they just be like fighting it out. And they're it's super like quick and fast paced and fun to watch.
Okay, so will you be doing play by play? Like, could you give us a little demonstration of like a short sequence in one of those games? How you would do it if you were doing it real?
I guess I could use an example from a tournament I watched. This is like a pro tournament, not just high school. Last stock scenario, last hit. Leo's looking for the up smash, but however, Tweak is trying to roll in. You see Leo going for the edge guard. However, Tweak is able to reverse it, get back on stage. Tweak makes a mistake, rolls in. Leo gets the up smash. It's game over. Leo takes Evo 2019. I love that game because the guy who ended up winning it actually made a reverse 3-0. So he was down 2-0 in the set. And that game kind of decided it because if he lost, he ended up losing the entire tournament. But he's able to turn it around from that moment and end up winning it all.
All right, nice. Nice.
What do you like to do besides video games?
I played soccer for Hill for all of high school. I really love soccer and staying up to date with what's going on in Europe. I don't pay attention to MLS as much, but I'll definitely be looking at what's going on in Europe. And I just love like playing soccer. So,
what's your favorite subject? You mentioned philosophy. Is that a subject per se, or?
I would say that's more of a hobby. I think just reading about that, finding books about it, and just reading stuff online would definitely be more of like something I do, on my own time. But my favorite subject, I would have to say English. I personally don't like English, but I do like the way that it makes me think. Recently we just started reading Hamlet. And so it's just interesting to see like different characters and different ways that people would act. And so I always find that super interesting.
I know somebody asked a question on how do the fans cheer on the esports, and I was one of those fans, so there's an open chat room. And so the bashing goes back and forth that way.
Does your sister let you tutor her?
No, she's smart enough. She is.
And she's right next to
she's
him.
She's right here, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, she also got the academic excellence from the Rotary Club too. So she is too smart for me as well.
That's a nice big brother.
Yeah. And don't be surprised if somebody in your college life end up changing your majors because of an experience you have. That happens a lot.
Okay. I mean, I'm always open to anything, really. Nothing's really set in stone, so.
Ernie, have you heard back from the schools you've applied to? It sounds like you're waiting to hear back from, was mentioned Stanford and Notre Dame, or have you heard any correspondence from them yet at all?
I've heard nothing about those two schools, but I applied early action to other schools, and if I so right now Madison is looking like the school that I would go to if I didn't get into Stanford or Notre Dame. So
going on what Nina said just a little bit ago with the changing your major, I was an advisor at a state university in California for a number of years. The data there said that students change their major at least 3 times in their career. With your interest, I hope you're open to all the ideas. It sounds like you really are. And I love the fact you're going into this with kind of an uncertainty, and I love that you haven't picked it yet because there's so many things. And I remember the discovery of going, I didn't know that was a major. You can major in that? Like, that was an eye opener. So I really applaud your openness going into it. And it's okay not to have it figured out. You will definitely find what you love. I'm sure of that. And congratulations on this great award too.
Thank you. Thank you.
So what do your folks do?
So my mom, she's a debt collector. She works at IC Systems. And so what she'll do is she works for Sprint. And she'll call people if they have outstanding debts. She'll just call them, ask them to pay. Some people are very resilient, but it's tough. And my dad works at the Best Buy headquarters in Richfield. So he works in IT, and he kind of manages not only like the coding and IT part of things, but also the business part as well. So he kind of acts as a go-to for both sides.
Cool. I just want to say that I'm surprised that Brian hasn't said anything, and maybe he has, but Rotary has several $6,000 scholarships available. So talk to your counselors to see if you can get an application if you're interested.
Okay, I'll definitely look into it.
Any other questions from any Rotarians?
Are your parents there that we can see them, or?
Yep.
Yeah.
Have them come around?
We're gonna move this around, so.
Okay.
Oh, it's kind of hard in the light, so maybe come back over this way. Why don't you come on over here and then you can see.
Must be proud of your son.
There we go.
That's better. Yay.
There we go.
Well, thank you for
Hello, everybody.
Raising
Good
such
morning.
A wonderful person.
Thank you, all Rotarians.
But where did the name Archie come from?
No.
Arnie.
I don't know, you want to answer?
Yeah. So, friends of mine just started calling me Arnie. My first name is Arnav, and sometimes people would mess it up. And so in sixth grade, people just started calling me Arnie, and it just kind of stuck. And now I go by it regularly, so.
Don't forget your roots. Very proud. Very proud.
Yeah, and let your sister tutor you if she needs to.
Well, thank you once again for being able to come to this meeting and getting to know you and your parents. I appreciate Aaron and Kelly putting together this event for us. And again, congratulations, Arnie, for the recognition that you are receiving from us and Hill Murray School.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your time.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for being.
Yes, and just in closing, I've got the plaque, and I'll be updating the plaque later on in the spring. And then when things get back to more normal, I'll be dropping by the school to deliver it back to the school for the fall.
Sounds good.
Thanks,
Brian.
All right.
Great. Well, thank you, everyone. So interesting to see all these students and know, you know, we've got really good people coming up and hopefully they'll join Rotary later on. So thank you very much for joining us and congratulations, Arnie, and wish you the best.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Okay, well, let's move to announcements and then we'll circle back to happy finds and happy bucks. Again, Bruce Mulgren had a birthday this week on the 7th, so happy birthday to Bruce. Reminder that there is a board meeting on Tuesday the 16th, so please get your agenda items to April by Sunday. And if there were some members that volunteered for the cleanup at White Bear Lake with Randy Comfort. Thank you to those who helped out. Maybe Randy can tell us about that a little bit later on. And now we're going to play a video, have a picture and a video of Terry Furlong's induction. Terry Furlong, you have been proposed for membership in the Rotary Club of North St. Paul, Maplewood, and Oakdale by Rotarian Joel Stallman and duly elected. Therefore, it is my pleasure to formally induct you into this club. I understand that you are aware of Rotary requirements and that you have indicated your willingness to follow them, as well as your willingness to offer your services to assist your fellow Rotarians in their community and international projects. As you know, Rotary is a service club with each member performing what Rotary terms service above self. In addition to service, you will have the benefits of strong bonds of friendship with fellow Rotarians locally and worldwide. Now I present you with this packet of Rotary literature. I understand, especially commend to your attention the object of Rotary and the four-way test, which form the criteria for Rotarians in their daily lives. And now, by the power vested in me as president of Rotary Club of North St. Paul, Maplewood, and Oakdale, Joe will pen the Rotary emblem on you and declare you to be an active member of this Rotary Club.
All right. Ta-da.
Welcome to Rotary. We all look forward to the enrichment of your life as well as the lives of your fellow Rotarians and by this association in the world's oldest, largest, and finest service organization. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.
Everybody, please welcome our newest member, Terry.
Thank you, everybody.
Welcome.
Terry, where are you right now?
I'm in Austin, Texas.
Woo-hoo.
My horns. Home.
It was nice to have an induction that didn't have traffic noise where we could actually hear you.
Yeah. I'd like to thank the camera person. That was Joe's daughter. She did a wonderful job.
Oh, wow.
Emma did a great job.
Very good. Well, thank you, everybody. I appreciate it. And I look forward to working with everybody and really making an impact on our club here. So, or being a part of the impact of what you guys do. So thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Terry. Thanks for tuning in from all the way down south. Let's just move over to Sergeants of Arms. We'll see if we have any happy bucks today.
All right.
All good.
Look at that hat. Holy smokes.
It is Hill Murray Day, and it is St. Patrick's Week. And top of the morning to you.
Oh, laddie, you look great.
That's good.
How's everybody this week?
Is it just us, or is Myra with us too?
I haven't seen her this morning.
Okay. And you're not in the office today. It's spring break?
I'm not there yet. Oh. We are on spring break, although I haven't taken those days yet, but I'm going in. I'm having this meeting with an extra cup of coffee at home this morning and going in sometime. The students are gone, so that it's just time for me to get caught up is what I'm trying to do. But yeah, it's even a little bit of change of pace is a welcome thing. So, and I'm in a newly finished room, so a lot to be grateful for. We were able to finish a downstairs room that had been unfinished since 2003 and prior to that, because we've lived here since then. And kind of excited to have a new space to
to have and for guests. And we have a lot of out-of-town visitors on a regular basis. All my family's in California, and my wife's family is in Florida, Tennessee, and northern Minnesota. So they're kind of all over the place. We're a hub of sorts. A dormant hub for some time, but hopefully in the future, not too far away. An active hub.
So that finished room, Randy, that's worth a few happy bucks.
I'm going to contribute for both the finished room and the nearby pantry hallway cabinets that are also installed that match the rest of the cabinetry in the house. That is really, really beautiful. We have a great guy in here in White Bear Lake who did it. But I also was going to contribute a happy buck or two for last Monday. I got to go to the Vikings training facility in Eagan, and then I got to go inside and see the place. The reason for that was the Johnson & Johnson single dose vaccine. So I was able to get that there, but really it was about the facility. I'm kidding. It was good to see both, to do both. So I will add for that for sure.
That's awesome. Randy, did you end up going out to the White Bear Lake cleanup? Maybe you could tell us a little bit about it if you did.
Yeah, I sure did. A neighbor friend of mine, he and I went out together, and the scout troop was a little smaller turnout this year, or at least it was hard to tell because we launched from Bel Air Beach on the south side of the lake. And normally that's several hundred people that take off from that point and span out across the lake. But with the event being kind of decentralized this year, and there wasn't kind of a gathering afterward, it was other groups may have also come in from different parts of the lake over by the VFW or by the beaches on the northern part of the lake as well. But the great news is, in many years of doing this activity, there have been, you know, we'd bring bags, whatever we bagged up from the lake, and we'd weigh it and then, you know, tally how much total weight. That usually comes out in the paper about a week later. And the good news is that this year, that the lake was hands down far and away the least amount of stuff to pick up on the surface that I've ever seen, and that I've seen in my 10 years of doing this. So it wasn't a huge turnout of people, maybe 40 to 50, give or take. But you know, when you span across a lake that size, it doesn't seem like many. In fact, it probably was, but nobody brought back really significant things, with one exception. And I don't know how this happens, but somebody found out on the ice and brought it in, put it in the dumpster, the hood of a pickup truck that was left somewhere out on the ice. Like the entire hood of the weight that we gathered this year was probably distorted because this one item was worth probably 10 bags, 20 bags of trash. I don't know, but how does somebody leave a hood of a car?
They probably used it for a sled, bringing the stuff out to the fish house, just left it.
You know, I could be. That actually could. That is absolutely the single most plausible thing I've heard yet.
That was my thought, was a sled.
Wow. I'm still a Minnesota newbie in regards of, you know, ice fishing.
Well, and just play. You know, it's the first thing that came to my mind was, well, I would use the hood of a car for a sled. So that's how I thought of it.
Randy, I wanted to pick up on this too. Randy, I wanted to pick up on this. The White Bear Press this week, the front page article showed Troop 89 picking up garbage off of White Bear Lake.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's kind of a kind of a cool legacy, because like I said in the email, that the scoutmaster for Troop 89, Jim Schuster, has been doing this a long time. His own son, I should say, got his Eagle Scout in like 2006, and he's still been running the troop ever since. I guess he still loves it. And this was his son's Eagle Scout project, was to organize the first time this event was done, but it's lived on through the conservation district since then. So it was kind of a
Just kind of a cool legacy for an Eagle project. Normally it's something that, you know, is stationary or you get to see for some period of time. I love the idea that an event can be something that lives on like that too. So Troop 89 has a deep connection to this one.
I have a happy buck, a couple happy bucks I'd like to pay. Number one is I get my second shot on St. Patrick's Day. So by April 1st, I'm going to be good to go. It's a good feeling. And the second one is I want to congratulate Joe, and he has left, Joe Miller. But we've had some issues over the park project with LS Black. And originally, John Opine was assigned to be our project manager on the concrete work, and was assigned to somebody else. And the work was less than satisfactory. So Joe had been fighting with LS Black on a $20,000 bill for their work for probably the last year. And this last week, Joe was able to negotiate that down to $10,000 for the work that was done. And I congratulate Joe and am very happy that, as treasurer, I'm very happy that he was able to do that. So we've paid that bill and we're clear with LS Black. So
that's good.
Can we add that 10 grand to the thermostat?
Now it will be used to help balance budget, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have, you know, Barb, and I have an announcement. Are you going to have announcements later, or can I do it now?
No, go ahead and say it, because I already kind of did my announcement. So go ahead, Brian.
Okay, and I'm stealing a little thunder from Sonia right now, but we got to thank you from the Dictionary Project for the dictionaries that we received through them. And in the thank you, they've said that cumulatively they've given out over 33 million dictionaries. And our club alone has given out 10,824 dictionaries over the years. So congratulations to our club and what we've been able to do with the dictionaries. The next thing I wanted to tell the club is I had a nice telephone visit with Lee Strozinger this week. And Lee apologizes for not being able to be with the club on Friday mornings. And the reason he isn't is that he has staff meetings, Zoom staff meetings at 8 o'clock on Friday mornings. And he finds it difficult to do both Zoom since he's preparing for his meeting. He does not want anybody to think that he is leaving Rotary. He's looking forward to the times that we meet together again and wants to continue to being an active member. So I'm glad about that. The sad news is, and Lee has asked me to pass this on, and many of you might be aware of this, but Lee and Maggie have separated in their marriage, and does appear that it is headed for divorce. And it is an amicable divorce. It is one where they want to continue to support their two children and not to abandon them. And Lee has asked me to make that announcement so that it makes it a little easier for him as he visits with our Rotarian friends. So with sadness, I am making that announcement for Lee. So that's all I have, Barb.
Yep. Thanks, Brian, for the update on Lee. And hopefully we can see him soon. Sorry to hear about the marriage breakup there, but.
I got a happy Brian. Today, about 5 weeks ago, we had our second shots at Carefree Assisted Care. And during that time, we still have 150 units of townhouses out front that weren't in the assisted complex. And so I sent an email to our senators, Weiger and Housley, and then Virginia Reinhart. And we got the ball rolling to do a vaccination event at Carefree. And that's happening today. In fact, I'm gonna leave here in a few minutes. It goes from 8 o'clock this morning until noon. And everyone kind of jumped on board, and they put us in charge. They put my sister-in-law, who's our compliance officer and staff member at Carefree, put her in charge, in touch with Minnesota Health, you know, whatever that name of that place is. And they organized it, and today's the event. And last week I had mentioned it, so a shout out to them, and also a shout out to Nancy Livingston, because Nancy's Chuck Weiger's kind of chief of staff, and she gets right on that stuff. I talked to her, and she's like a bulldog, you know. So she, and then there's Congressman Peterson, and there's a bunch of people that really jumped on board, because a lot of our seniors are the 70s, 80s, and 90s have a hard time navigating the computers. And when they do get in, a lot of them don't drive. So they have a hard time, you know. It's hard to take public transportation out and have them wait 15 minutes while you get the shot, you know. And so everything came together, was perfect. We have some very happy seniors, and we're going just like Randy, we're going with the Johnson & Johnson today. And I'm happy to say it. I don't want to steal Nina's thunder. In fact, I'm going to let you say it. But anyways, a shout out to all the people, leaders in our community that made this happen. And we have some very, very happy seniors. And I'm going to go work it this morning. WCCO is coming out. So if you want to watch the news tonight, they're going to cover part of it, I guess. So anyways, I'm happy. So
that's awesome, Bruce.
That's great.
Nina, you want to pipe in?
Yeah, I got $3. I've got three happy bucks for my mom. She's 95, and we can't take her to a arena and make her walk blocks to get there and stand in. I mean, it just wasn't practical. So Bruce graciously got my mother at 95 finally in, and then my sister and I, who take care of her, we're of age, we also got in. So big happy dance to Bruce, and thank you. So today,
that's awesome.
Yeah, when I get up to heaven, I'm going to say, okay, I did all those things, but you know, I also did this.
A show of hands for who's been vaccinated at least once so far. To start. Yeah.
There is an announcement today, if anybody hasn't seen. There was an announcement today that the governor is speaking at 11 a.m. about fairly significant restrictions that are being lifted. I pay attention to that for school's sake, but also just curious as to see what some of those other announcements are today as well.
Well, I'm hoping, I'm the newest season ticket holder for the Minnesota Twins, so I'm hoping he makes a little bit of a announcement about how many of us they're going to let in April.
And I've got a cruise, so we'll catch you guys later.
Hi, Bruce. Right.
Happy birthday, Bruce. Again, Bruce.
Thank you.
Joe, you'll appreciate my nephew sent me a picture. Nephew and brother-in-law sent me a picture. They live in Naples. The brother-in-law does. The nephew lives here with my son in Circle Pines. And they sent a picture from a particular tavern in Fort Myers that's owned by, and a picture with, Ron Gardenhire sitting in the middle of the picture. So
very nice.
Gardy looks as tan and, you know, as usual.
Yeah.
Like, and he's just fine.
He's retired now, right? He's no longer the manager of the Tigers.
He's no longer the manager. I think he's a consultant of some sort for at least one of the teams, but yeah, he's definitely retired.
When I was at the spring training game for the Twins, Gardenhire's son was the first base coach. And that was just 3 weeks ago we went.
So that's Toby?
Toby. Yeah, he was the first base coach that day.
He's now the head coach of the Saints.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which is our AAA affiliate.
Which is an affiliate. And I think that's what they had him there, you know.
Yeah. That'll be good. You know, Gardy is no stranger to North St. Paul. You can you can run into him at the Legion every once in a while. He's got some good close friends down there, and I've seen him here in our town a couple times.
Joe, so I should ask you. I've been looking for this for a while, but I've been told that Tom Kelly lives in the vicinity of Hill Murray.
Yeah.
Yeah, he lives right by the Hillcrest, just east of the Hillcrest Golf Course.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. And of course, MPA is just down to a little bit to the west of the same Hillcrest Golf Course. So I've been looking for him. Every time I go to my favorite little, you know, Nino's Pizza, yeah. I'm thinking I'm going to walk into TK in there, but I haven't seen him yet. But
yeah, you can almost see his house from there.
Really?
Terry, you were going to say something?
Well, I was going to say, Joel, you'd appreciate this. Toby used to be a part of our K Club.
Oh, is that right?
Yep, used to come in the store quite a bit. Well, not quite a bit, but every now and then.
Okay. Pick up
a nice IPA keg or something for himself.
Very good. Are they still doing that? I'm a member over there, but I haven't seen the book lately since you sold the place.
Well, the kegs right now are interesting because all the bars, you know, being closed.
Yeah.
We took a tour of one of the distributors a couple weeks ago, and their keg cooler was almost empty. And that's typically, I don't know, a huge warehouse of just kegs, and it was almost completely empty.
Wow. Yeah, I got to say, when COVID hit hard, Terry called me up or sent me a text and said, man, do I have a deal on kegs for you, because I have a kegerator in my basement. So for pennies on the dollar, I got a nice surly keg that I'm still working on because it's a big keg. I can't finish it. We can't have parties, so it's just kind of me sipping on this thing. But that would have been a $300 keg, and I think I got it for about $50. So thank you.
Amazing.
No demand for that right now. So.
Joe, you just had to put it out in your front yard and Mitchell will be over.
Yeah, I could probably reel him in pretty easy, huh?
Yeah, that's real hard.
Hello, neighbor.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. I should have put it out by
the
way.
You know, when I go on bike ride, I go on bike rides, I could easily swing by on an outdoor keg stop. There's just, I mean, just work that into the route.
All right.
It's a lot closer than having to ride out to the Gasthaus for a beer.
Yeah.
We should have a Rotary bike club, and then we can, you know, stop at everybody's house for, you know, like beverages.
Well, so right. Now I got to pick on Ray if he's listening. Ray is, I'm an amateur compared to him. What do you have on tap right now, Ray?
Really exciting. I have a Castle Danger cream ale. I have I have a Hawaiian one from Hawaii, and I also have a geek breakfast stout from San Diego.
Oh, cool. Very nice.
Yep.
And have you been able to keep up with them? I mean, you know,
no, I haven't. Parties? I haven't had anybody over either. They're just kind of sitting there.
Yeah,
it's been rough.
We'll get there.
Yeah, we'll get there eventually.
Do they lose their fizz?
Somewhat. I mean, they're on CO2, so they really, I mean, if you're not opening them or anything, it's not so much they lose their fizz. It's not clear that they're kind of go bad after a while.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're not pasteurized, so they don't have any, what do you call it? So they last about 3 months.
Yeah. Okay.
Sounds like a drive-through experience.
You shouldn't drink and drive.
No, that's a terrible idea, but I like it.
You don't mind, I'll quick share a story here of my travel yesterday. You know, we're down in Austin, Texas, and we took our daughter to a nice restaurant on Lake Travis. It's up in the Bluffs. It's called the Oasis, overlooks the lake, just beautiful. To the right, there's million-dollar homes. So after lunch, we thought we would go and do a little traveling. We like to go to parks and, you know, kind of see what, do a little hiking and go down by the water. So after lunch, up in this beautiful area, we're going through this neighborhood, million-dollar homes, and ran across a hippie hollow park. It's a state park on Lake Travis. Supposed to be a beautiful park. And we go to the entrance, and there's a building, and you know, you got to pay to get in. And the lady looks at us and goes, "Do you know this is a clothing optional park?" And we all looked and we went, "No, we didn't know that." She goes, "Yeah, this is a clothing optional park, and it's $8 per person to come in." We said, "Oh." She goes, "Well, there's another park just down the road that's $5, but it's a regular park." And so we said, "Oh, okay." So we turned around and went to the other park, but I looked it up. It's the only state park that's clothing optional. I've never heard of such a thing.
Wow.
Well, did it have hippie in the name?
It had hippie hollow park. Yeah, I should have known right away.
You know what Austin's trait or saying is down there? Anybody know what they say about Austin? Their bumper stickers? Keep Austin weird. It's a little hippie oasis in the middle of a red state, and they embrace it. You know, they say keep Austin weird. So that's perfect.
That was weird.
Does anyone know what time the governor's announcement is today?
11 a.m.
So, Terry, I think on that announcement, instead of happy bucks, it should be hippie bucks.
I'll pay. I'll definitely pay.
See, I'd be willing to put in money for something like that to make sure that people didn't have to experience, hey, look at that guy on a partially clothed beach or clothing optional beach. They'd pay me not to.
Yeah.
We could make some money.
We could make some dough right there by more kegs.
New fundraiser.
Any other announcements? Any other happy bucks out there?
Quiet group. It's weird when we do it in the opposite direction, when we have all the time in the world.
Yeah. Okay, it sounds like we're wrapped up for today. So we'll kind of have a shorter meeting, but since March is the Water and Sanitation Month, our inspirational quote for today is, without regard to whether someplace is wealthy or poor, everybody should have the chance of clean air and clean water. That's by Barack Obama. So with that, I'll close up the meeting and everybody have a happy and safe weekend and fun day on St. Patrick's Day. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everybody.